Shall we introduce ourselves first, right, Lucy?
You start.
Okay, my name is Jana Seiniger. Hello from Switzerland. We have already quite late evening. I'm one of the partners of Four Solutions. We are implementing solutions and running projects in the area of EPM since the last millennium.
My name is Luzi Zappa. I'm doing this now for 30 years. And you can see I still have the old Hyperion cap. And I'm working very close with Jana. We have a small team in Switzerland and we're implementing financial consolidation, planning and all that stuff. Our agenda is an introduction to our company, then traditional challenges. And we want to highlight, or we want to explain mainly tonight, segment reporting, what are the new challenges, conclusions, and of course, questions and answers. We are from Switzerland. Switzerland, the country of the mountains, the country of the red and white flag, as you see it in the picture. So our logo is very similar to our flag, just in blue. And we're very honored to be presenting here today. What is our business? Switzerland is in Europe, in the middle of Europe. We have started usually with financial consolidation. We have done over 200 implementations in financial consolidation. We have also done projects with financial planning or planning in general. Then, of course, management reporting and business intelligence. These are the EPM, or if you want to call them CPM, areas of this business solution. We have used very often Hyperion products, HFM, Hyperion Enterprise. I have implemented even microcontrol so that you just see this. What are we doing? We are in the area of implementing, or we call it also consulting, of financial information systems. We do also data integration to all kinds of systems. For example, also to SAP ERPs. We do business intelligence, meaning advanced reporting. We do also professional training and rollouts of systems for multinationals. And we support the clients. We do hotline, maintenance, and all of that stuff. And as I mentioned, we have done implementations with microcontrol. I've done the first implementation in Switzerland back in 1990, 30 years ago. Then we did the first Hyperion Enterprise implementation in 93. And we also did the first S-Base implementation in Switzerland. Then we started doing Upstream when Hyperion acquired the company Upstream. It's the new name is called FDMEE. You might all be aware of that. And that's mainly in the DACH area. D for Germany, A for Austria, CH for Switzerland. And we did the first HFM implementation also for a Canadian company back in 2003. And we're working now also, not only, but also with OneStream. For us, client customer success or knowledge transfer and a very high quality like Switzerland usually delivers with Swiss watches and chocolate is very important to us. What are the traditional challenges? So if you look at a financial consolidation point of view, it's multi-currency translations, including currency translation adjustments, CTA, and using historical rates, also transactional currencies. And our highlight will be segment reporting. That's why we put it in orange. There is multi-level consolidation, like for example, a full consolidation and a sub-consolidation. We also do intercompany or inter-segment consolidation between segments or between legal entities, investment and equity elimination, minority calculation, proportional and equity, method consolidation, multi-gap, meaning, for example, Swiss gap, German gap, UK gap, and of course, American gap. And then pre-profit elimination, those are all the items that we can cover in the application, usually using HFM. So Jana will now explain what we have been showing I don't know anymore, 18 years ago, segment reporting. So
okay, so when we look, Lotus Tate, please, one back. Okay, so, you know, as Lucy mentioned before, there are many challenges and many topics for every consolidation project. Today we picked the topic segment reporting, which is for some company more important, for some less. But before we go into the details about implementation in HFM and the technical possibilities, I would like to talk a bit about what do we mean with segment reporting, what it is about. If you are a company with different business areas, you might have the need to consolidate your data not only according to your legal structure, but as well according to business unit structure, or however you call it. One of our customers, for example, is in the retail business. Their business area would be, for example, household. Another business area would be baby food. And within this baby food, they might have business lines like milk, vegetable for the babies, etc. Another customer, which is in the area of the oil business, they might have different split, and they're splitting the company by refining, trading, etc. So it really depends on your business, on the area the company is working for, and doesn't matter how you call it, if you call it profit center, business unit, segments, but there might be different splits of the company you need to do reporting, depending how the company is well organized. And how do you want to do this in HFM? Usually you try to use custom dimensions, etc., to build kind of a matrix. So on the one hand, you consolidate the data according to legal structure, and on the other hand, as well, according to your business structure. And therefore, it's often as well called so-called matrix consolidation, or segment reporting for IFRS, etc. And now let's have a look on some examples and technical options how you can implement this in HFM. Lucy, next slide. Yes, so from HFM perspective, or from the perspective of other multidimensional consolidation tool, we see three different approaches how you can build this in. The first option is basically the traditional approach, as you would have been doing in older tools like IBM Enterprise, where you put everything in your entity structure. I will bring more details for all of these options later. This means you have everything in your entity structures and you're creating entities as combination of the legal entity and business line or segments. In the second options would be start using the dimensionality and put these segments into a custom dimension. But you would keep the ICP still in the entity dimension to not use too many custom dimensions. And the third option finally is the full multidimensional option where you would put the segment and the intercompany segment into two separate dimensions. So let's look into a bit more detail on the next slide. Okay, so in the first option, this is the traditional or the option as it was in the old days, you create everything in the entity structure. So if you look on the entities, let's say we have a legal consolidation with a sub-consolidation of entity one and entity two, and each of these entities was split into segment, see here segment one and segment 11 and 12, they might be for the second entity segment 11 and 13, because not all segments are available for all entities. You put the intercompany flag on the lowest level, and therefore all your combinations of entities and segments are available as well as intercompanies. You might recognize this. This was something you would have used in the old days in IBM Enterprise. But there might be as well business cases where you still would do something like this in HFM or other tools. If you load or enter your data, you basically use your account and then entity and ICP dimension and the value. You don't need to care about any additional dimensions. Lotte, next slide. So what is the advantages is you can use the system logic because HFM out of the box gives you the ability to do intercompany reconciliation on entities and not on additional dimensions. This means if you use this option, you don't have to write any special logics. You can use the out of the box intercompany elimination logic and the standard intercompany matching reports for entities and the business units or segments, or how you call it. And only existing business units and intercompany business units are available. So you only create what is needed and don't need to care about blocking or not possible combinations. On the other hand, you are not using at all the multi-dimensionality. This means all the flexibility on reporting, etc., is not given. You need obviously multiple organization structures. As usually, you would create one legal structure with your entities and segments below, and an additional structure where you would put your business lines or your segments on the top and the entities below to have the business line or the segment view. The maintenance and the building of such structure could be quite time intensive. I remember in the old Hyperion Enterprise days, I was spending at some customers days or even weeks create hundreds and thousands of entities with all the combinations and being very careful not to make any mistakes. And it was a nightmare of maintenance and as well performance was an issue.
I'm sorry to interrupt you. We just got a request in that our audience can't see the full presentation. It's cut off on the sides and the bottom. I'm not sure if you want to reshare your screen and make sure that the whole presentation is showing. We can just see on the sides and on the bottom, there's just some cutoff.
Lucy, can you try to reshare it?
Oh, there we go.
Great, perfect.
Thank you so much.
This. I thought it's only me seeing this like this. Okay, great. Thanks a
Thank
lot.
Thank you.
Interruption. There is an issue, let us know. So basically, if you use this, if you're coming back and we created hundreds of entities as combination of entities and segments, as you can imagine, the maintenance might be quite complex. You don't have the really reporting and analysis capabilities, the same options like if you use dimensions, it's very limited. Security is usually very complex as you have created many security classes and groups and might lead into, again, high maintenance. Let's look on the next slide and the next approach. Yes, exactly. So the next approach is basically one step into the direction of using custom dimension. Here on the left-hand side, you see we built in a legal structure, we built our structure based on the legal entities. So we have a sub one, including entity one and entity two. On the right-hand side, you see a custom dimension where we create segments. So we have segment one with segment 11, 12, 13, segment two, etc. But for intercompany, we're not using an additional custom dimension, we're using the entities. Therefore, we create a block of technical entities which are not used for data input, just as an intercompany partner, and flag them as ICP. And here we create all the combinations which should be available, so only again what makes sense, and use them for ICP. We flagged them both entities and the technical entities as ICP and have everything in the ICP list. And depending on the accounts, if we need segments or not, we have to block or unblock what is necessary. So if we load or enter our data, we again entering data, let's say for trade receivable, and then we say which entity, which segment, and ICP is basically a combination of entity and segment. Like this, we're using custom dimension for reporting, but for ICP, which is usually the less important or not for the reporting itself, we put it into technical entities. Let's look now on the next slide, what are the pros and cons. So the reporting and analysis capabilities are of course much better. Usually when you analyze your data, you're only interested in segment. You're not looking on the details in IC segment. This you need only for the correct elimination. So with this solution, you can use this for reporting. You have less maintenance, more flexibility, and only existing intercompany business units are available. You use only one custom dimension. So in the old days, depending on your HFM version, where we had only four dimensions, or looking on some newer tools like the cloud version where the dimensions are limited, it might be an option to save a custom dimension for other needs. And as well, from the perspective of ad hoc users, smart users, might be as well an advantage, have less custom dimensions, as the users are usually confused if they have to use too many custom dimensions. As you're starting to use custom dimensions, you need to create special logic for the intercompany eliminations, and your standard intercompany matching reports will only work for a legal structure, but not for the segments or your business units, because HFM out of the box knows, let's see, HFM out of the box recognize only entities as intercompany and not additional dimensions. It was, I think, many years ago on the wish list, but it was never implemented in HFM out of the box standard. So you have to do your reports yourself somehow. You need technical entities for business units, which is not very nice. And of course, you need as well here to build and maintain the structures. For the entity itself, you need no input rules to block the not existing combinations. There might be business cases where this option is a good option, but usually you would then go if you want to use dimensionality, and especially now today where the number of dimensions is less an issue, you would go for the third option on the next slide, which uses the full multidimensionality. So on your entities, you only have your legal entities. Nothing more about segments. Therefore, your intercompany dimensions as well includes only your legal entities. In one custom dimension, you would create your custom tree, so segment, subsegment, etc. And then you will replicate the lowest level in an additional dimension. You might create as well the totals, but you might not need them, so you can just create a flat structure. If you then load or you enter your data, you need now to really be careful and fill all the dimensions correctly. So you have your entity with your segment, reporting against another entity and another segment. So now you're using four dimensions to specify your values. Next slide, please. So using the full dimensional approach, you have the best reporting and analysis options, obviously. You can slice and dice like you want and like you used using a multidimensional cube. You have reduced your maintenance, because when you need to create a new entity or new segment, just create one new box and don't need to take so much care about combinations in regard to the metadata, maybe only in your input rules, but the metadata, you just create one segment that's automatically available for all in entities, the same with your intercompany segment. So it's flexible and you're using the full multidimensionality. If you want to export or transform your data into SPACE or other multidimensionality tool, it's full compatible. Everybody from the OLAP world would understand what we are doing. Obviously, so said as we need to use additional dimensions, we need to create special logics. The intercompany matching reports are still an issue, and we use two custom dimensions to build this up, which might be a disadvantage, as I said, user creating their ad hoc reports, Excel retrieve formulas, they need to take care about additional dimension. And you need to create no input rules for the not existing entity and business unit combinations. So, yeah, that's good. So just an example about, as I said, we have the full flexibility on reporting with the CERT approach. So our bookings, you remember we have this trade receivable, trade payable between entity 1, segment 11, and entity 2, segment 13 of 100. When we now analyze your data, when we look on entity 1, we have this 100 on segment 11, which rolls up into segment 1. If we consolidate it, so if we run a consolidation and then look on the sub-consolidation 1, we will still see on the segment 11, which is the lowest level, this 100, but on segment 1, which is the parent of segment 11, 13, it's eliminated because it was an intercompany between 11 and 13, and then you see a zero. So this is the matrix consolidation I was talking about, built up in custom dimension. When you look on this analysis and looking onto different options, it might look like the third option is always the preferred option. I would say this really depends on the requirements. If you have a big organization with many entities and many segments, and the most entities have multiple segments, then it will be most likely the third option the best. Depends as well how many of the accounts are split by segments, etc. But there might be as well other business cases. We had, for example, an HFM customer where we were contacted 2-3 years ago. They were saying, this was not our customer before. They came to us and say, we are not happy with our HFM application. One of the issues is the performance. It takes us 45 minutes to consolidate a single period. We are not talking about budget. These are hours if it doesn't break. The business case of this company was they didn't have hundreds of entities, maybe 80 or 100, I don't know, don't remember exactly. They used as well segments, but only a couple of entities, like 3 or 4 entities, had segment and only few. But the application was implemented with 2 custom dimensions. So every entity has segments and intercompany segments. So there was a full matrix consolidation built up. And we redesigned as well the rules and optimized it. But we as well changed the design approach. We went from the approach 3 to the traditional approach 1 because it was only like a couple of entities, couple of segments. The most entities had no segments. And at the end, changing the approach from approach 3 to approach 1 in this case, we improved the consolidation time from 45 minutes to about 40 seconds. So what I want to say, it always depends on the business case, what might be best for the customer. We had another customer where we were doing this on 2 custom dimensions. And in these cases, you might start doing something like the option 2 and combine it somehow. Can we go to the next slide, please? Let's see. Okay. There are some more points to consider when we're talking about segment reporting. When we're looking on the design of segments in HFM or similar products, The first question would be as well, which accounts can be split by segments? We have customers, they're splitting the whole income statement and balance sheet by segments or business lines. We have other customers, they're splitting maybe only income statement below EBIT by segments and some balance sheet items. This really depends. This is important to define in the beginning. Then you need to define the segment hierarchy and as well the level. How far into details you need to go in your consolidation tool? Do you have a hierarchy with 100 members or is this just the main segments, or are you going into thousands of members? I mean, don't do too much. It's a consolidation tool. You need to kind of keep a certain level out of the system. And then really analyze if your intercompany segments is required. Because I would say the most customers we have, they have segments, but they're not using matrix consolidation. They say, okay, we're splitting our data by segments, but the intercompany segments are not important. Either it's always within the same segment or it's immaterial, or we book it then differently. So I would always challenge this before starting creating intercompany segments, either in entities or a custom dimensions. Really challenge this and check if this is needed. And then once you have all the information, then you can decide on the implementation approach. What is as well very important and might influence your decision, what you build up in your system, is what is available at the local site level. If you have a big company with different source systems, you might have difficulties to load the data. It might be sometime needed to enter some data manually or reclassify manually. And then you need to take care about your data entry screens. As you know, as more dimensions you use, then it will be more difficult. Using functionality like add items, you can use only with one dimension, not with two or three. And if you use the multidimensional approach, you need to really do something smart. It might be you need to do step-by-step approach or drill from one entry form to another or something like this, or filter by point of view, etc. We had as well a customer, they found it helpful for people entering data to show what the intercompany already has loaded or entered on their screen. So we used an additional dimension to put the information of the partner into the entry screen. This might be as well an option. So it might be helpful for intercompany reports. And as well, think about scenarios. It might be in your actual data, you have the full information, but in your budget is irrelevant. Or in your budget, you want to write automatically the information into the intra-company partners' books. And there might be as well some additional requirements, which might give you some difficulties. You might have the need to allocate non-segmented accounts. We as well talking about cash flow and KPIs. I had a customer, they had their segments only on a part of income statement balance sheet, but they wanted to have the cash flow fully by segments. So the accounts which were feeding the cash flow were not splitted by segments. We needed to allocate based on the split of EBITDA, for example, on the cash flow accounts to have it segmental. So there is a lot more. We could talk much longer about this topic. But this was a short overview of what is about segment reporting. If you have any questions, we did this as many customers, you can contact us later or ask the questions. And now I would like to give back to Lucy, because we were talking about the traditional challenges which company having since we working with Hyperion Enterprise Microcontroller HFM, but we found as well in the last months and years, and especially in the last months with the special situation, there are some new challenges the company are now meeting. So, Lucy.
So, what are these new challenges? These new challenges are, in the last years and months, some of the traditional challenges are no more an issue in that sense, but there are new ones that have come up. For example, changing of assumptions that you have other reporting scenarios, for example, or you have to build up simulations, for example, or you need to speed up your reporting cycle in that sense, or you have to introduce some planning features such as the rolling forecast. And that could be an issue that you have to implement it in the same application. Or for example, also cash planning, financial planning, all that kind of stuff that you have to build in. One item for Europe and also for Asia, maybe less for the United States, is IFRS 16, that you have a model for the leasing concept that you have to implement in your application. Then a new question that arises is more an IT question, is on-premise versus cloud. Do you want to keep it on your servers, or do you want somebody to serve you with the software and do all the updates? Oracle is offering this with their new tool, FCCS, or they call it now EPMCS, which is having FCCS and planning and other tools inside the same solution. Then there is the best in breed versus one provider platform. What would you like to choose there? Then in Switzerland, it's quite a secure country, but in certain items, we have experience at three clients of ours, cyber attacks, or in other words, IT security. HFM has been hacked and they couldn't access HFM anymore. So it was on their own server. It was on an on-premise solution, and suddenly they had no access anymore. They couldn't consolidate. And we had to solve this issue by recovering the backups, or by now doing kind of a cloud version in that sense. And another question is, what's the future of HFM? Are they going to continue HFM, or will you swap to FCCS, EPMCS, or to another tool? SAP has a new tool. There's a new company called OneStream that is offering consolidation. There are other tools like Tagetik and LucaNet. So what is the future of your HFM application? Do you want to keep it? We are now merging a couple of HFM applications to 11.2. I think yesterday, Jana, the new version of 11.2.2.3 has come out. And of course, software and application support is also a question. Who can still deliver the hotline? We are still able to do it. We even still provide help for Hyperion Enterprise clients, which we don't like, but these clients have decided to keep it still. What are some of the conclusions? So software decisions are based on finance and IT strategy. So you will have to talk with your IT department, with your controlling department, your CFO, maybe even your ERP plays a role. Flexibility is one of the key factors. I think one of the most important key factors, because consolidation, management reporting, financial planning, or other planning solutions will become very important in this sense. The whole thing is growing and becomes much bigger, and you have to be much faster, and you have to provide flexibility in the reporting. Then, of course, reliable support and consulting is essential, so that you still have consultants who understand the old software, or who can bring you into a new area, who can give you new ideas, can solve your problems, and who can speed up your reporting process. And of course, it's always necessary to review and redesign existing applications. What has been done in the past is not necessarily the best solution in the future. So maybe you want to improve your application. Maybe requirements are changing. Maybe your CFO changes and he has new requirements. So the application changes. And with this, we turn over to questions. If you have any comments or whatever. It is now night in Switzerland. Mm-hmm. It's almost 11 o'clock. We are still very active in this area. We have 100% satisfied clients. We work in efficient small teams. We have two or three clients, I think, Jana, in the United States, even in California. So we support them via remote access. We try to bring our knowledge to the client so that he can actually build his application or support himself. And then only with complicated questions he might ask us. And we are always committed to high quality and a timely project implementation in that sense. So 4Solutions is providing solutions for you. And I would like to say thank you very much. And yeah, if you have any questions, this would be our presentation. And thank you again for everything, for your attention. Hello.
Thank you so much, Lucy and Jana. We really appreciate you taking time out of your evening over there in Switzerland to present with us at Solutions 2020. And we love that gear, Lucy. We really appreciate you guys.